the thousands, and yet you'll never walk a mile in the shoes. Left at the curtain call, another broken man, some more material.
And now for your weekly dose of metal. Here are your hosts, Morgan Danielle and Luco Blaze, on The Metal Experience.
All right, we just heard Throne Alone. I like the little rhyme scheme they got going on there, by Heart of Jordan. And then we heard You Don't Know a Damn Thing by El Famous. And their new music video is up on the YouTubes. Morgan tells me. Right, Morgan? No. Right, Morgan?
I was distracted by a pig next
that
to you.
You're the best. I'm Luca Blaze with Morgan Danielle. Sitting next to me is Charlie the Chuckle Factory, a.k.a. Burpee McGee. And we are rocking out here at the Metal Experience in the dungeon tonight for a first time, Synovial. Why don't you guys go ahead and introduce yourselves, what you do in the band.
All right. So my name is Camille, and you know, you could say I'm the one who steers the ship that these beautiful men built. I'm the vocalist.
That was so stupid. I love you
We're
so
much. We're off to a great start.
Perfect.
Captain Camille.
I mean, to be fair, he's the best looking guy, so.
Sure.
Damn.
And my name's Chris. I play the bass.
My name's Ross. I play drums.
My name's Josh. I play guitar and I sing like the pretty stuff.
My name's Dylan. I also play guitar. And make sure you tell Josh that he does the cleans, not the singing.
Fuck off with that. We hate when people say that.
Can't stand it. Can't stand it. What he does is not singing. I'm not discrediting what he does. It's just using technical terms. He is not a singer yet.
So, yet.
It is a common misconception.
Yeah.
It is.
Well, why don't you guys give us the beginning. When did the band form and how did you guys come up with the name Synovial?
That's Ross and Dylan.
Yeah, so thank you, Chris. right as I got out of high school, like in 2010, I went to college and I was no longer in the band that I was previously in with Josh. This is like 8 years ago now.
What was that band called?
That when I was in the band, it was called Seeking Zero. The name changed, went on for a while, and then something happened. I don't know. But so I went to college in Davenport, Iowa. And just being a bored freshman who hadn't discovered drinking and partying yet, I just played guitar alone in my dorm, and then I texted Ross, because he was my drummer friend that I knew. I'm like, hey, I want to do a band eventually. And then over time, we would send each other like riff ideas, and he would put drum parts to them. And we stayed as like just a guitarist and a drummer writing dumb instrumental songs for a while. then eventually we expanded out. So I'll let Ross take over. You could probably give more insight about the name and everything.
Yeah. So I had to think back on it, but Dylan and I had pretty much decided that I think we started playing the summer of 2011. So 2010, we all graduated from high school. 2011, Dylan and I, like you said, we're kind of working together to like just make some stuff. And it wasn't really supposed to be anything like crazy. We didn't want it to be like, I personally didn't have all these aspirations to make something huge. Like, oh my gosh, we have to make it big or whatever. It was just something fun to do on the side. But after a while, it became, so we were playing together and kind of sending each other files with, you know, just music ideas. And then after a year or so, I was, as this is where the band name came in. Again, it was a project. It was an unnamed project. And I was in my human physiology class my sophomore year. And I went to my human phys class for the first day. And I was 40 minutes early because I'm a nerd and I had no friends. And
that's going to be a common theme amongst us.
Yes. Yes, you will find that out. But, so I was sitting in this classroom alone, just, like, bored out of my mind. And you know how you get those assignments where they tell you, like, oh, you have to read, you know, pages 40 to 56? No one ever reads them. But I do look at the bold-faced texts, and I just read the definition of words. And that's my... you know, that's my homework. That's me doing my homework. But I was looking at the bold words, and I texted Dylan while I was sitting there alone, sad, with a tear in my eye. And I was like, you know, there's a lot of really cool, like, anatomical terms that would be really cool for a band name. And synovial was one of them.
What were some of the other ones?
Some of the other ones, well, the one I can think of that I almost picked was Anasarca. And Anasarca is basically a full-blown, like, body inflammation, essentially, is what it means. It's very, very bad, yeah. But it's called Anasarca, and it sounds kind of pretty, in my opinion. But, yeah, there was that. There was, I mean, gosh, everything under the sun. I mean, I don't know. I mean,
that would have been
glenohumeral, you know, I mean, all sorts of crazy stuff. But Synovial was, that was awful. But, I mean, I was just looking
through the shoulder,
the hip bone. The yeah, right. Cuboid, you know, all those really dumb names. But Synovial was the one I really liked. And I've always really enjoyed that name and that word anyway, just because our synovial joints are in our shoulders and our hips, and they're called ball and socket joints, right?
Okay.
So they give us all of our range of motion, yeah. Right? But they're very complicated structures, so... it kind of, at the time, was sort of a symbol in my eyes as far as what we wanted to accomplish, which was to have all sorts of different unique parts and somehow put them together and make it coherent.
Are you a chiropractor?
No, but I do work in a chiropractic office.
What?
But
damn!
She was rocking it.
Wow. She knew it.
But yeah, so I've always really appreciated it, and I always liked the symbolism behind it. But... and then, so it was just us playing for a little while, and then in 2013-ish was when Chris came in.
Yeah, I don't know how it happened. I know I was talking to Ross because we're like high school friends, obviously, but I got him into Rock Band because that was when Rock Band was big.
Yeah,
and I think one time he just came over to my house and just noticed guitars, and randomly he just texted me. He's like, "You play guitar, right?" And like, I mean. Badly.
Well, we were desperate. Like, Dylan and I were desperate because we just wanted to have somebody to play with. Because as much as I love Dylan and everything, like, we can only go so far with what we were coming up with. You know what I mean?
Yeah, so
we
wanted someone else. So I did the rhythm stuff, you know, so that way there's just an underlayer of the song, and then Dylan would be able to come up with, you know, pretty riffies, you know?
Pretty riffies.
So
that's how I came in. And then I think later Josh was recruited. And I kind of, I was purchasing a bass to learn bass because I was always interested in bass. And I kind of just bumped down, but it worked out.
Well, Dylan and I had always wanted Josh to be in the band.
Yeah, I was away at school. So, like, I went to community college for 2 years. And I think we did a decent amount of, like, jamming, like over the course of, like, maybe 2012, maybe. And then I went to school at Illinois State. And I was in a couple of other projects that were kind of going on. I didn't really have the time. Like, we'd jam over the summer, but nothing was ever too serious. And then I think, like, I think they had made some like junk track of Frostbitten.
Frostbitten, yeah.
And they were like, write lyrics to this and do stuff. So
well, it was our way of basically, because he admittedly, and I don't know if Josh would ever admit this, but he was apprehensive about joining.
Oh, for sure.
And,
for sure.
Okay, yeah. So he admitted it. I was wrong. But he was apprehensive about it. So I think it was like Dylan and my way of just basically being like, hey, Josh, here, like, come take on. This thing and tell us what you think, so that he's like sort of putting his foot in, you know, because he's not going to say no.
So, right, like, right.
So he helped us out with that.
Right, yeah. So, but, yeah. So wrote that, and I think I recorded it on like a really like shitty microphone
awful.
On my shitty like computer I was using for school, and sent it back, and it was like, okay, cool. And then I think the next time I came home or whatever, we jammed and we played it and we did it, and then it was like, okay, all right. Yeah. And then we had the search for like another vocalist, because I was not going to do the screaming.
Well,
duty.
So we, most of us, well, Dylan and I don't know, you didn't and you didn't. So I guess Dylan and I were the only ones that graduated from college in 2014. So we wanted to get something going, and we asked Josh to be a part of it, and then he actually wanted to be a part of it, but you couldn't get out for another year.
Yeah, I had another year of school.
So he basically said, after a year, I'll join and I'll be more a part of it. Mm-hmm. And so that's when we told Nexi, like, hey, go to bass and we'll get Josh in for singing and for guitar. And then during that, and then once in 2015, when Josh graduated, and we all kind of had more of a selective group, then Mexi found Camille in his classroom. They're going to NIU together, and you can tell that story, Camille.
Yeah. So I was taking physics, and I ran into this one old high school friend, and that high school friend had a friend who was Chris.
Hey, that's me.
And at first, Chris kind of seemed like standoffish. But he saw my background on my computer, which, no shame, it was Ollie Sykes from Bring Me the Horizon.
Nice.
Of course it was.
Because that's my ride or die band. But
and his Beartooth shirt.
And my Beartooth
shirt. Beartooth for life.
Yeah.
He saw the background, and then like we were walking out of class, and he's like, by the way, dude, do you like do vocals? And I'm like, literally, that's what happened.
Do you like do vocals?
And I'm like, yeah, I mean, I've been in a few bands or whatever. I can, like, send you some tracks if you want.
And how Chris didn't know that. We all went to the same exact high school.
Right. Yes.
At the same time.
Right.
Camille's the four of us were in the same grade. Camille was, like, a year younger than
I graduated 2011, so I'm the youngest in the band.
Right. So how Chris didn't just know that you did that was stupid.
Well, I think Chris did know. He just didn't know how to talk to Camille.
No, I don't know.
You didn't know?
Because I've never met
then
Chris.
Maybe you're dumber than I thought.
And, so, obviously, I sent him tracks of my vocals. He sent it to, like, his guys or whatever.
I'll send him and, like, send my guys.
Totally kind of like that.
They said, like, he told me that they liked it or whatever. And then we were studying, like, in this random hallway one time, and he was, like, showing me the MIDI tracks of some songs. And I'm like, by the way, like, what are the names of the guys in this band? And he's like, Ross, Josh, Dylan, and I'm like, I know them.
Yeah.
And it was just this weird, like, meeting, like, obviously Chris to join a band that's, like, back in my hometown or whatever. It was, like, kind of, I guess, I don't know, it was pretty cool.
People you already know.
Yeah, like, yeah. I didn't know Dylan personally or Josh super well personally. But
we played in bands, like around each other.
Right, yeah. But, like, I knew Ross a little better.
We played together. I mean, you were actually at my house.
Yeah, I was at his house a few times back in high school.
Right.
But, yeah, so it was kind of cool how that came together. And then, I just started coming to practices, and they never told me to leave, and I'm the vocalist. So.
Yeah. I mean,
I guess I do a decent enough job.
Yeah.
Right?
I think it's a cool story. The fact that none of us auditioned for this band, we just all kind of came together and just never left.
Yeah.
Like, that's kind of really how
it kind of showed up.
Yeah. I mean, we knew we liked these people. We actually probably more looked into personalities more than anything. Just like, hey, these might be cool people to play. And they just happened to play an instrument. And that was it, really. But no one, like, auditioned. No one came in. Like, I think Josh was really the only person that, like, Dylan and I both were like, we would like to have this person in the band.
Sure.
But other than Josh, I don't think, like, we had any idea that this was going to come together in this way. So it's kind of cool.
So, yeah. Long story not short.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
So what year was this that you officially, were you the last member to join the band?
Yeah, yeah. That was either late
2015.
That was, late 2015.
It had to be late
it was,
2015.
Right? Yeah. I'm trying to think when I started my program. It was probably like late 2015.
I'm pretty sure it was late, yeah.
So since late 2015, what have you boys been up to?
We started gigging a year ago.
We've been active for 1 year. We were literally just jamming, honestly, in Ross's mom's basement every weekend or so. We'd just jam. I would learn the songs and stuff, and like we would just have a good time. And we never got super serious about like playing shows or releasing stuff till we felt like super confident in our product, I guess you could say. You know what I mean? Like, and then we got offered like a first show with some really good friends. And we were just like, yeah, you know,
time
let's
to come
do
out
it.
Of the closet.
And that, yeah,
time to come 100%. Out of the closet.
And it was a year ago in July. Was our first show, and I mean, yeah, it's been fun.
I think Luca was there. He just showed up after our set.
Oh, really?
What show was it?
Was this a rooftop show that you left me out of?
Yeah, it's the rooftop.
Fuck you, Luco. This night gets worse and worse for me.
We opened that show.
Yeah. Wasn't that at Penny Road Pub?
Yep. Yeah.
That was on Penny Road. And that show was sweet because I didn't even know there was a fucking rooftop up there.
Yeah, we didn't know.
We didn't either. Until like a week before. Yeah,
played Penny Road like a billion and 12 times. Yep. It feels like. Who knew there was even a roof to stand on?
It was so badass.
That was pretty. So I was at that show.
It was really fun.
Yeah, you were.
So I want to know how hard. No, no. I told Luca I wanted to go to a show at Penny Road Pub that night because
I heard your Aletheia. I heard the Aletheia podcast.
I wanted to go so bad. Yeah. Because you know Aletheia, there are guys right. I love
and Fool's Brew.
And Fool's Brew, Fool's Brew. You know, stack lineup, and I was like, "Holy shit, it's a rooftop party! I want to go." This asshole goes, "I'm playing hockey." I'm like,
"Playing hockey?
Okay, so what do I do on a Friday night when he's playing hockey?" Sometimes I just make a mess in my basement. I'm just scrapbooking and, you know, watching movies. And this jerk texts me that he's at a show at Penny Road Pub.
Wow.
And I'm like,
come on, man.
Dude. He's like,
we were like 2 minutes away
this
from
is unbelievable.
The venue. Like, literally.
Unacceptable behavior.
I looked it up. We were like, it was like a 6 minute drive. I was like,
I got left behind.
I'm like, there's a show going on. It's like
why
6
not?
Minutes away.
Yeah.
Let's fucking go.
Our friend had told him, let's go to the show. It's at this bar up down the road that I want to go see, you know, whatever. Let's go have a drink. And sure enough, it's the show I wanted to go to that this asshole's hanging out at.
Right, right.
Like, are you joking?
Unfortunately.
You should have come to hockey, brah.
Brah.
We'll dedicate our next show to you, Morgan.
Thank you.
How's that sound?
It was pretty funny, though, because we were, like, on Google Images, like, in the map section, like, Google Maps, like, looking, like, that roof is slanted. There's no way we could play.
Yeah, it looked very sketchy, yes. Like, from Google, because we were like, researching, like, okay, what is this roof?
Yeah, because no one's ever been on there.
Because no one's ever played it.
I've never even noticed the door.
Yeah.
Like, I walk right by, I'm
exactly.
Like,
right?
Dude, exactly.
I didn't know there was a door there.
Like, oh, they're like, the door's right here. Like, that's been here this whole time?
Yep.
Yeah, that was pretty
Penny Road,
sweet,
always full of surprises.
Started to rain just a little bit, but
yeah, it did. It drizzled, but it wasn't bad at all. Mm-hmm. But yeah,
that was our first show, Luco, and I could have been there.
We would have missed it anyway. We had no plans of playing a show at all, really, until... So Jake Farhang from Aletheia, he produced our first album.
Triage.
Jake!
Jake Farhang.
Yeah, so I think we had made the decision to record before we even thought about playing shows.
Absolutely.
And
we wanted to record. I think that was the agreement between the band.
Yeah, but it was just like, we were just like, okay, cool. Like, we're going to record. And then I think overwhelmingly, I'd say Dylan was probably more of the driving force. Just like, guys, we know how to play songs.
Let's play a
Can
show.
We please just like do this for real in front of other human beings, please?
Yeah. Jake totally promoted us like to do this. You know, he wanted us to do this. He asked for us to play and
he believed in us.
He believed in us. And that was great. But you know what? The way that we kind of looked at it was like, hey, it's a casual thing. We're going to open for these guys. That's awesome, right? But then it wasn't until, like, I think it was 2 weeks before we played, then we realized, oh, crap, there's a hype for us because Jake hyped us up more than we thought he was going to. And so we're like, shit, now we actually have to be good. This is not good, you know. we were like, this is not good. We are not prepared for this. But it ended up going really well, so.
Yeah.
I mean, he also trusted us to play the Aletheia party a little bit after that. So.
Yeah, that was our second show. Yeah. Was the fifth
like,
Aletheia
like,
party.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure he was hesitant to put us on the bill, but
he put us on.
He put it
on.
Yeah. So yeah, we owe all of our like in front of people playing to Jake.
To Jake and Aletheia in general.
Yeah,
Aletheia
for sure.
In general, we owe a lot.
They hooked it up.
Yeah.
Boy.
So we will.
Yeah. So so we did that, and then we started playing shows pretty regularly, and we finished our recording with Jake, released Triage, and then. Post that, it's just been shows pretty constantly, I would say. And
fairly consistently.
Yeah. And then
We recently recorded a single with Sam Botner.
From Barrier.
From Barrier. Good, great guy.
Funny guy.
Hysterical. I have not cried in a very long time from laughing.
Yeah.
You never expect like this sweet, peaceful yoga man to be as
right. And I'm screaming these relatively, dark lyrics, but then in between takes I'm crying laughing because of Sam.
It was quality stuff.
So and his antics.
Yeah, so we did that and then shot a music video with our friend Alex Zarek. And released that 3 weeks ago. Now?
3 weeks ago, to the day.
Yeah, to the day. 3 weeks.
3 weeks ago.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, the CD triage. How many tracks are on that?
There are six.
And why don't we go ahead and introduce the Metal Experience World to you guys, Synovial, and play one of the tracks off of Triage, and then we'll come back in and we'll talk about it.
Sure.
Go from there. What do you guys want to open up? Playing.
We might as well open
just play it in
open.
Order.
Just play just Chain play Link,
it.
Yeah.
Yeah, just play in order.
What's the first track?
Chain Link is
Chain
the first
Link.
Track.
All right, let's do it. Chain Link by Synovial.
Hi, I'm Brandon.
Hey, I'm Ben. We're from Snow Burial, and you're listening to The Metal Experience.
We are back. I'm Morgan Danielle with Luco Blaze.
Morgan, what was the name of that song we just played?
Chain Link.
Okay. Charlie's here, too.
Obviously, he's chuckling.
Yeah. Chuckle Factory.
Chuckling Charlie.
Who's
Charlie?
He's making owl noises. Ignore him. It's okay. We are back with our friends in Snowville. We were just starting to get into more of like the recording, and we'll talk about the upcoming or the music video that you guys released. Real quick, but wanted to ask you guys a little bit about what Chainlink is about.
Luko, I think you are such an asshole.
Josh should be a good one for this question.
So lyrically, I watched I think I was just like at home on like a weekend or something and just watched so much Gangland. I think that was the name of the show.
Gangland.
It's just that show that just like features all of these like gangs in particular, and then interviews a lot of like their incarcerated members and kind of like how they go about things. And like the one common thread that I kept on picking up on was the fact that like the dudes who were the most fucked up and like the ones that were doing more of the heinous shit were higher up on the food chain in the gang. But if they could turn for the police, right? If they could like rat, if they could live with themselves, you know, being a rat, then the police were also willing to give them more, like more of a payoff to you know, to flip sides. So it just felt so weird to me that like, you know, you're like the system in on both sides is praising the people for being the most ruthless and whatnot. So yeah, just in my head, it's just like I wanted the song to sound like somebody who had just committed, you know, some kind of crime and was running to escape. And like in every movie ever, there's always an escape where they're in an alley and they're jumping over like a chain link fence and like the cop can't do it or whatever.
Right,
you
can't, you
know,
over
and they get
fat.
Right, too fat or some shit. And like they can't do it, so like the criminal gets away. So yeah, just that. Like there's just like this tense, you know, like rush of a right. of the crime.
In the early stages too of that song, which is kind of cool, was Josh was over at my mom's house when we were writing that, and we had written the majority of it really quickly, actually, because we kind of kept with the same concept. And so when we had written a draft, we brought it upstairs, and I showed my mom, and because I'm a mama's boy, I love you, Mom. And
wait, like
mom.
You
I
recorded?
Do love my mom.
Like,
no, we record. I mean,
like crudely, on
crudely
phone.
On a phone, okay. Right? Yeah, yeah. And then put it on the speakers, and I just had my mom listen to it, and she's
over there.
Oh yeah, she's going crazy. Yeah, absolutely. No, she hates metal, but
sitting calmly on the couch,
yeah. Sitting very
calmly, nodding
on
her
the
head,
couch. Exactly. And I was just like, "What do you think?" And she said that it reminded her of a criminal. It reminded her of someone running away from the law or something like that. Like that's what it reminded her musically, which was awesome because it was already an idea that Josh had.
Right.
So it was like, all right, well, I guess this has to be, because that was before the lyrics were even written.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So we were like, okay, well, I guess this has to be the song now. So it was kind of cool how it all like melded together.
Yeah.
But
so that's Chainlink.
That's Chainlink, yeah.
Fuck yeah.
So let's get into your recent music video release, which has been blowing up YouTube. Very quickly.
YouTube?
Facebook.
More Facebook than
more
YouTube.
So, yeah. We've got like 1,000 views on YouTube, maybe.
Like 1,200.
1,200 views on YouTube. We've got 80,000 views on Facebook.
And like over 1,000 shares.
Yeah,
it feels pretty cool, yeah. So, thank you to like everyone.
Yeah, thank you
who
literally
listened,
any human.
Or even, yeah, even listen for like a few seconds and turned it off.
Yeah. Yeah. So what do you want to know about that?
Well, I wanted to know, where did you guys record it? What was the idea behind it? And
so we recorded with Sam Bodner
at his dad's place.
At his dad's place, half in a studio.
Well, wait, are you talking about where we recorded the video?
Yes.
Or the song?
Oh,
both.
The video.
Both. Okay, well, okay, we could talk about both.
Gotcha.
Okay, so we recorded the like the audio of the song in like Sam at Sam's dad's place, and then Sam also has like a buddy. I don't remember his name. He was so nice.
Who?
The day you recorded drums.
Oh, Austin?
Austin.
I think it was Austin?
Sure. Fingers crossed it's Austin.
I really hope it's Austin. I'm so sorry.
Sam rented out a studio space where his buddy Austin had just like bought space to like actually like lay down in studio for drums and all that stuff so we could like properly record.
It's Vince. It's Vince.
Vince.
It's Vince.
All right. Sweet.
Sorry, Vince.
Sorry.
So
Vince.
From
sorry.
A to B real quick.
Right, right. Yes. I'm so sorry. Okay.
Yeah, so we recorded that there so that way, because like that was the first time that we actually had Ross like studio hooked up, you know, like studio mic'd
right.
and everything like that. So we did that there, and then the music video
Josh was looking for spaces.
Yeah, I was looking. I was constantly looking for space. What website did I use?
I don't even remember.
Okay. Peer space. Thank you. Thank you, Dylan. Yeah. So
that.
So we were just we've been talking about doing a video forever. We were gonna do a video for Chainlink.
Yep.
Like earlier in the year, and it just never it never worked out. And I think that we were more like waiting on like the right song to do it for.
Yeah.
Because like that was so late after the fact. You know what I mean? Like you released an album and then
it was
like
just
2 months
what's
later.
The point at,
yeah,
at
2 months later, yeah. You release a music video. That just seems
exactly.
Not that didn't seem like gel well with us. So. I couldn't find a place. I'd already reached out to Alex Eric. And I was like, I knew him from college, and he's a good dude. And he's been all over the place. He's like working for Victory Records for a period of time. Like, dude's kind of like been around. And just looking at places, looking at like anywhere that we could where we wouldn't have to spend a shit ton of money on like you know noise permits and anything like that. And we were like, okay, what's a creepy place that we could do this? And then we were just like, okay, well, let's be more practical. Let's try to find a space that we could turn into whatever we need it to, you know, to be. So I just found this place on Pier Space and
ballet studio.
It was a ballet studio in Chicago, and yeah. I'm gonna blank out on her name, and I'm not gonna look at my phone because it's gonna take me a while. Sarah, holy shit,
Dylan, just plugging them
VIP,
in.
VIP,
just
Dylan.
Plugging them in.
Yeah,
what a
Sarah,
piece.
Sarah, and she was like the easiest person to talk to about like everything that we needed, and we we planned it like and keep in mind like there were still classes going on in this building right. And you could fucking hear us.
That was my favorite part. Like,
yeah, exactly.
Every time there was a take and I was like taking a break and it was just right. Like Ross or Josh or like Dylan and Chris, like I would just go to the bathroom or like go outside and chill, eat a snack.
Yeah.
And every time the first fucking guitar part comes in, which is the quietest part of the song, by
yes.
The way. You could hear it outside
yeah.
In like a bathroom like a billion feet down the hall.
Yeah,
like
it was
you could
ridiculous.
Hear it in the entire fucking building.
Yeah. But it worked. I think it really worked out. I mean, even though not so much conceptually, but like it still felt good to do this song in particular considering the concept. To do it in a ballet studio.
Absolutely.
That felt kind of cool. Yeah.
Yeah, it was cool. And it was nice because they already had like lights set up in there and stuff for us. You know, we could kind of, we had the board to, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
Light up wherever we wanted to light it up or whatever.
Yeah.
But it was so loud in there. I mean, I remember when we walked in there at first, it's basically a gymnasium. It's basically what it is, a small gym, you know. Ballet studio, and I remember when I think I tapped my snare drum like on my knee or something as I was walking in, and it was like the loudest piercing sound. I'm like, they said full volume on drums, right? I'm pretty sure they did.
Right, yeah.
And I'm like, we're going to die. We are
apologize
not
to everybody on our way out.
Yeah,
we were just like, I'm
we
so
were
sorry.
Everyone
did you get
sweet.
Any compliments? Did people?
Oh hell no.
Like, no.
They just said they said that we were nice. That was it.
That's
yeah.
Like,
right.
They just said that we were.
You guys are nice for Satan worshipers. Interesting. Yeah.
So what is 525 about?
You can go ahead with that. Or do you want me to
sure, I'll go ahead. 525 is a prologue to a concept that we had come up with. Well, it was so originally it was an idea that I had for just a normal song, which was about a kidnapping, essentially, and wrapped around just the horrible emotional turmoil of, you know, a parent losing a child. And I came up with this little excerpt just to begin the song, and I kind of sent it to Josh because Josh and I are the ones that work on the lyrics, and I sent it to him and I was like, this might be a cool thing to do, and this is you, right? Okay. I'm just making sure. He was like, this might be a cool thing to do, and it was funny because a piece of me was like, this actually might be cool for a full concept, but we'll see. And then Josh like 10 minutes later texts me, he goes, this would be cool for a concept if we just did this. So I was like, okay.
Right. Well, I think
we'll do it for.
Yeah, I think you mentioned it, and then I like double checked you on that because I was just like, we could do this, and then I just started asking Ross like a million questions.
Yeah.
Just like, okay, so this is the idea you had for the song. Okay, who's getting kidnapped? Who's doing the kidnapping? Why are they doing the kidnapping?
Right.
Who's the father of these kids or the parent of these kids? You know. This, that, and the other. What time of day is it? What kind of car are they driving, et cetera?
It was so extensive.
Sure.
And he made me think about it more. And then he brought up the idea of maybe we should expand on it a little bit more. And that's where it is. So We decided to make 525. Again, it's a prologue, so we decided, okay, we already had this thing with Sam, you know, that we wanted to do with the single. We didn't have enough material to write a full album, obviously, so we're like, it just makes sense for this to maybe be the precursor to a concept album in the future. And so basically it is a song that touches on every single point of view in this kidnapping. The father, the kids that are taken, the kidnapper, and basically just kind of splits it up within the song and just kind of gives you just enough to know what's going on, and then we expand on it right. later on.
So hopefully. If we did our job right.
If we did our job right, yeah.
So I've been watching the music video on mute just to see if you can tell that you're in a ballet studio.
You can't really.
Right.
I've been watching it the whole time. And I'm like, I've been looking for any, like, I don't know.
Ballet shoes.
Some ballerina in the back just walks in the back.
Yeah. Or like the leg.
But the lighting, that was just perfect how their lighting was there. Yeah. It looks fucking awesome.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Well, I think what was cool about it, which wasn't an idea that we... So when we went into that music video too, we had no idea. We had some ideas, but we didn't like have a real concrete, like, this is what we want for this video. And
none of us had done a video.
None of us had done it. Yeah, it's our first time. And it was a great experience. Yeah, it was
There was a stick flip.
Oh, I'm... yeah. Oh, man. I got him on the stick flip. Yeah.
That's funny.
But, yeah. But what was cool about this whole thing, though, was the lighting. Because when we were there, we didn't know what to expect. We kind of just hoped that Alex could walk, just waltz in with this place and be like, I know exactly what to do.
Yeah.
You know, that's kind of what we were hoping to happen. And we really like the light, or I do at least. I can't speak for anybody else, but I like the lighting in the video because it's about a prologue. It's about something that has nothing to do with us as a band. We're the ones that are expressing it.
We are the silhouettes.
We're the silhouettes, right? And this is something that is not about us. And so I think it's cool that the lighting sort of
visualize.
Yeah, visualize.
And the flower.
And for the record, Alex totally waltzed in there and said, I know exactly what to do. He told us like where to set up the drums and like where to all stand. And yep. then we totally just knocked it out.
What was your question? I'm sorry.
Oh, and the flower in the music video.
Right, there you go. Yeah. There's the concept.
There's the concept.
That's it. That's the only clue. Because we had two options. It was like either shoot a performance video.
Right.
And kind of give people who won't get to see us or haven't yet seen us like physically like play at a show a vibe for kind of how we are on stage a little bit, you know, or like just like show our faces or do like a concept video. And that just like for our first one, I think doing a concept video would have been extremely bold and I think with less payoff than if we had already like had like everything established, you know what I mean? Like this was just a prologue and people have never seen us before. Let's just be us and let's give these tiny little hints. So, you know, maybe people who have only heard the song orally, maybe they'll pick up on the fact that it's a concept via the lyrical content or whatnot. Or people who watch the video, maybe they'll see the pedals and they'll be like, why are they sometimes there?
Right.
Why are they not there the entire shot?
You right. Know? To so. Reference your flower thing, it's a reference within the song about, mm-hmm.
We refer to the kids as petals,
flowers.
Yes. Yeah.
Damn.
Yeah.
That's why
shit,
our shirt
deep,
design.
Son.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, we try not to make it too obvious, but we want it to be subtle, and we want it to be subtle, but not like in your face. We want it to be an experience audibly, as well as visually, so that people don't just look at a video. Like I feel like at least for me, when I watch a video of a song that I really like, I'll watch the video and I'm taken back by the video, but the song is just not impactful to me as much as if I were to just listen to the song.
Right. They should be on equal playing field.
Exactly.
Like you shouldn't have an extremely conceptual, like high concept video and have a song that doesn't deliver that unless
the song is like that.
Sure. Unless it's like a design choice.
Exactly.
I think that's just really what it is. It's like, it should all be a design choice or it should just be a performance video and you're just playing the song and that's it. You know,
also shout out to my mom for letting me rip out like 10 real daisies for not only the music video but also the album art.
Yeah,
which we
shout out to Camille's mom.
Shout out Camille's mom.
Camille's mom. Hey, woo. Sabula mom.
She's the best.
Yeah. She cute.
She cute.
Well, I'm sure our listeners are eager to hear 525 in their ears. So I think we should take a minute and play that track and then come back in.
And you can also find it on the YouTubes and on the Facebook page.
Indeed, yeah, YouTube. At Synovial Band on YouTube, Synovial, it'll be like the first option.
Spotify.
Yeah, every outlet.
On there. Apple Music, Google Play. Amazon Music, if you use that.
Wherever's convenient for you is where it's at.
Yep. We made it easy.
Well, here it is. 525.
Of the four corners of my Well, hi there.
Hello. We know you're enjoying your current dose of metal with the people at the Metal Experience. What are their names, Ryan?
Hey, Morgan and Luca. How you doing?
Well, howdy.
Should you get through with your dosage with them and find yourself still wanting metal, come see us at the Epitome of Stupidity podcast. You can find us on Podbean, Spotify, Google Play, iTunes, and other places, I'm sure.
Yeah, and it's cool. It's a cool show, I must say.
Until then, back to these guys.
Bye-bye.
Woo! All right, we just heard 525 while I watched the music video for 525 by Synovial. Check it out on the Facebooks, the YouTubes. I'm Luca Blaze with Morgan Danielle. Sitting next to me is Charlie the Chuckle Factory on the Metal Experience. Rocking out in the dungeon in the basement while Jazz Knight kicks ass upstairs. Right, Morgan? She doesn't know what's going on.
It sounds like a good jazz
band. Yeah, it sounds like a great jazz band.
Fantastic.
They're twice a month, they're up there jamming.
So awesome. So good. I love jazz.
I like when they get the jazz singer in there. Ooh, ooh. Yeah. Shoo-bidi-bop-bop. What the fuck? Well, anyway, it's about that time.
Is it?
Charlie the Chuckle Factory is going to fuck us up with some truth.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it's time for Chatting with Chuckles.
Ha, 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 ha. What's going on, guys? It's Chuckles.
He makes him sound like he's some sort of demon. Charlie, you do give me nightmares.
If you could see his eyes right now.
Charlie, I anger bait thinking about you. What do you got for us?
It's true. I've walked in on him.
I got some tour newses.
Okay.
First one is awesome and also sad. Kyle Pavone from We Came as Romans passed away Saturday, late evening. 28 years old.
That's brutal.
Huge bummer.
I was actually on my way home from over at my buddy's house from Comic-Con. Mm. I was scrolling through
what
Facebook.
What Comic-Con?
Chicago Comic-Con.
There was one.
Wizard.
Wizard World.
Yeah, it was over at
Rosemont.
C2E2 is coming up in, I think, March.
April-ish.
Yeah.
It was rad this past year. Next year should be cool. But Kyle Pavone, pretty brutal. Too young, man.
Do we know what happened?
Too young.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know.
No one knows.
From what I've heard, an autopsy takes 2 to 3 days.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very
rest
sad.
In peace.
Yeah.
Rest
seriously.
In peace. Too young. Too
Legend.
Young for any
rest
of that.
Rest in peace. Huge influence
and
for me in high
just
school.
Wrote
and
one of his
college,
best
so.
Albums.
Yeah, their album is supposed coming out in October and. I don't know if they're still going to be going out on tour or if they're going to push it.
Yeah, I don't know. They were supposed to play with
Bad Omens.
Our friends in
All
Famous.
Lounge. That's supposed to be September 12th, which is a Tuesday with, as you guys said, Bad Omens and All Famous.
It's a Wednesday.
Oh, come on, Charlie. It's a Wednesday.
Tuesday or Wednesday?
It's a Wednesday, September 12th.
It's a Wednesday. What else you got for us, Charlie?
They're playing the next day up in Racine, September.
Who is?
We Came as Romans.
Oh, I thought you were saying something else. Okay, continue.
Tour ends October 16th in Vegas at the House of Blues out there. Beartooth has started their tour last Friday, and they're also coming out with their brand new album in
October 1st. September 28th. I can't fucking
September?
Wait.
Morgan's
it's pre-ordered,
counting down the days.
And I'm going, and I can't fucking wait.
Yo, hold up. Knocked Loose, though, on that tour. Fuck.
That's
yeah.
going to be killer.
Those guys are fucking murdering it.
Just wait till Beartooth steps up. They haven't let me down yet.
They've only let me down a couple of times.
Fuck you, Luco. No one cares about your opinion when it comes to this.
A couple of years ago, I was supposed to see them at Warped Tour. And
ooh.
Beartooth.
Yeah, we missed them too that day because they played first. Those sons of bitches.
Yeah, because I never even saw the stage that they were playing at.
But we did end up seeing Attila first that day.
Didn't we? We couldn't even find that stage. Whatever stage they were playing on, it was like in the back corner around in an alley down the road.
I think that's the year that they like
away.
Redid the whole like setup for Warped Tour before they went back to something that was a little bit more easy.
How much of a bummer is that, though?
Terrible. Yeah.
You're like so ready to go see one like of the bands, billion bands.
And really the first band of the day, and I'm like, you.
Then you get there, and then.
Yeah. Right, yeah, the only Mayhem Fest that I ever went to, Whitechapel played first. It was Whitechapel first, and then Black Dahlia Murder. Mm-hmm. And I showed up halfway through Black Dahlia's set, and Whitechapel just played, and I was like, are you kidding me?
At the Aragon? By the time we walked in, it like the first band was already done.
That's happened plenty of times.
Beartooth again?
No.
Was it Beartooth, Under Oath, Bring Me the Horizon?
No. The one show that he's referring to is when we were at House of Blues. We were seeing August Burns Red. We just had found out who Beartooth was. We were going. We were stoked. And we missed our set because of traffic. But I bought the EP that day.
Nice. It's me and Carbomb.
Yeah, it was terrible.
Damn traffic. Yeah,
so Carbomb. That's the other time we missed
Beartooth. Or when we missed Killswitch because of fucking the fucking traffic to get to Aragon was terrible.
What are you going to do?
Yeah, exactly.
All right, so Beartooth's tour started last Friday, August 24th in Germany. Stops in at Chicago at House of Blues Monday, October 1st.
Fuck you, Mondays.
Stops at Pops Thursday, November 15th in Saugan, Illinois. And
Pops, is that the Euro place?
I don't fucking know.
He's just the news guy.
That's the Euro joint.
You can't expect him to know
that
shit.
That's the Euro joint, I'm pretty sure.
Wow.
Hey, if you want to call it that, sure.
Okay.
And then their tour ends November 17th in Ohio.
At their hometown.
Okay. Morgan wanted to go to that?
I did. And then nobody was down to make the trip to Columbus because they're like,
because it's
Chicago's just so much more convenient.
Well, when you take a step back, you realize it's Ohio, and you're like,
I want an adventure,
Ohio.
Guys.
Hey, if you go to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in Cleveland, it's worth it.
See,
100% worth it.
You I want to go a on a weekend and just.
I work on the weekends.
Have an adventure.
That sucks.
It reminds me of
I'm
that
video. Do it
ever
by
seen
myself.
That video, that Cleveland, Ohio video, where it's like, we're not Detroit.
Yeah.
Like, every time I think about Cleveland, I think about that.
It's like Cleveland rocks.
It's like cold outside. There's like a newspaper blowing across the street or something.
Under construction since 1868. So polluted, our fish have AIDS. It's great. Video's fantastic. Yes, it's so funny.
All right, Chucky, what else you got?
Thrice started tour last Friday.
Say what?
Cool.
I tried to ask you if you wanted tickets, you jerk.
Oh, yeah, I don't know any of their new stuff, so I said no.
They're newer.
You said
shit's
nothing.
Good.
You did not respond to me.
Are they like Under Oath? Did they like are they having like a renaissance of themselves or
aren't
something?
Aren't they more hardcore?
Like with some alternative feel,
sure.
Kinda like in that emo vein.
Emo.
I mean, they were always on the emo.
I'd put them
scale.
In the same category, kind of love like the Used,
sure,
mixed with like.
Well, right on. I'm happy they exist.
Post hardcore,
old Rise Against,
Cool. Meets maybe old Atreyu.
Must be old.
Oh, yeah.
Atreyu's got a new
like
album coming out.
Atreyu does have
an album. But their last album was terrible.
Yeah, what you know? I don't care. I love those guys. Get them to tour. I'll go see them anywhere. I love Atreyu. They're the band that got me in the metal. I'm
when
never
going to stop.
You
think about bands like that, you start thinking about like, if they asked us to go on tour with them, would they say no?
Like, actually, I haven't
if
been listening to your most recent album, so
yes.
I'm good.
I'd shit my
At
pants
this point
first.
In our life,
but yeah.
If we said no to a band... Then you know they suck. All right, but otherwise they're at least passable.
Yeah, we're no one. Yeah, we're
exactly.
No one.
So
we're
we
no
can't
one
be making
no
these
you.
Opinions, these negative opinions.
My favorite album by Atreyu is Congregation of the Damned.
No way!
Wow, that's shocking. Interesting. That's a shocking opinion. That's but right a, on though.
But to me,
the album's got like three good songs. Maybe four.
Because when I first heard of them, they weren't that hard, and that that album was more screamo.
What?
What?
More hard.
Compared to their previous albums, absolutely not. Absolutely not. It's a good album. It's just not what the previous ones were, which is fine. every band's allowed to do that. Every single one of us here still loves a band that hasn't put out a good album in a fucking decade.
This is very true.
So, you know, we're not, you know, that's not what all a band is not the album that they release.
What else you got for us, Charlie?
Thrice started their tour last Friday in Brazil.
Brazil, okay.
Yep. Stops in Chicago at House of Blues Friday, October 12th. And then they also stop at the Rave Friday, November 9th and up in Milwaukee. And then their tour ends November 18th in L.A.
Louisiana?
Yeah, Los Angeles.
Okay.
Shut up. Oh, my God. You're such
what else you got for us, Charlie?
Obscura.
Okay. Fuck me up with some truth about Obscura.
Their tour starts September 13th in Oakland. Stops at The Forge September 22nd.
That's a top five album of the year, by the way, the new Obscura album.
Still haven't heard it.
This is going to be a fucking awesome show.
Okay.
If they play with Beyond Creation...
And you got a huge boner for that band.
He's looking at it right now.
I can see it right now.
Fucking like bumping the table up.
Jeez, Luco, don't grab it so hard.
Sorry, Charlie. I get excited when you get excited.
Now we're all excited.
I'm not that excited.
Thanks a lot.
Just a bunch of dudes sitting around some tables.
Right, because our kink is your kink.
Absolutely.
I am so glad I have my own table.
Also playing with Archspire, In Fury, Exist, and Caicus.
Archspire is pretty sweet.
Doors at 6:30, show is at 7.
Okay.
Stops at Guest Monkey Bar and Grill in Dallas, Texas, Thursday, October 4th, and tour ends October 7th.
Well, fuck yeah. What else you got for us, cool guy?
That's it for tour news.
Okay. What else you got for us tonight?
Have you guys ever heard of...
what is it?
He doesn't even know.
He doesn't know.
Yeah.
It's like, hold on.
It's so obscure.
I haven't heard of
it.
You're looking it up? What are you...
Oh, no. He's
breaking up. It doesn't show up on the page. It's so abstract. It's unreadable.
Does it even exist?
He wrote it in invisible ink.
Catapult the Propaganda?
Yes.
Hey, have you guys ever heard of him?
No.
I have not.
I would like to.
He wants to. Tell him all about him.
Flea's brother passed away last week.
Yeah, we talked about it. We shared the GoFundMe page.
I actually went to the memorial service.
I'm waiting for the good news.
A little bit.
Yeah, that's good news. This is sad. I'm just sad now.
This is sad.
What I didn't get, though, was how he passed away.
I don't know that either.
He was a park ranger or something in Colorado?
He was actually a wildfire.
Brutal.
Yeah, I saw a picture with him with a fire in the background. Brutal. So there's a lot of fires going on east right now.
He was also up in Washington State.
Oh, okay.
Well, props to people taking care of our trees and our nature and shit, man.
Thank you. We don't have a lot of that left.
No, we do not. We do not.
We need to respect what we do have left.
Yeah, for sure, man.
And you brought a band to play tonight, cool guy. What do you got for us?
A band called Warhol.
Like Andy? Or like Steven?
Or like the Dandy Warhols?
Or the Dandies?
All same reference.
Like Jimmy Warhol and the Cum Dumpsters?
Nope.
I really hope it's that.
I hope that's a punk band.
You know it
Jimmy
is.
Warhol.
I actually met the lead singer at Comic-Con.
Okay.
Oh, sweet.
Good.
Yeah.
Hell yeah. Okay.
What we're playing a song by them?
They're a melodic / symphonic metal band.
Okay.
Cool. I'm excited.
I'm hyped.
My nips are hard.
A song that we'll be listening to is Voices from Above.
Voices from Above. All right. Let's do it. Warhol with Voices from Above.
You're listening to The Metal Experience.
We've assembled a collection of bands who have drummers.
Or do magic.
Well, it's easy if you try, Dick.
Now sit back and listen.
What's going on, guys? We just heard voices from above from Warhol. They're from Texas.
And they kick ass. It's Warhol, W-O-R-H-O-L. The album's The Awakening. This song kicks ass. Lead singer, so good.
I think they only have one album.
Well, this is the first track off the album, what we just listened to, and if that's any indication of the rest of it, then that's some good symphonic-type stuff.
It is.
It's real good.
I didn't get big into it, into a symphonic and all of that, but I liked the album. I thought it was really good.
Right on, man. Yeah. I mean, hopefully they would not take this as an offense, but I like a little bit of cheese. I think symphonic metal has a decent amount of like cheese with their like choral synth pads and all that stuff. But yeah, I mean, if you can make it work, you can make it work. And I really like that. And again, that vocalist, she's
good.
She's got so pipes. Good. Yeah, she's yes. She's so good. Like not like distinctive. She's very distinctive. I think that was good. I would listen to the rest of the album. If that album came up, if like a song from that album came up on like shuffle or something like that, I would continue to investigate. That was good.
Well, let's talk about some of the albums and artists that influenced you guys. We touched a little bit on it earlier, but what are some of the bands that got you guys started into metal or to pick up your instrument?
Like personally?
Personally.
Let's
Okay, yeah, let's
Everybody gets two. We could do this for hours. Everybody gets two.
All right, where do we start? Dylan or me?
Start with Dylan. Let's start with Dylan.
All right. Pickle. I'd say
pickle.
I started playing guitar because of the stuff I was listening to in middle school, which was like a lot of Sum 41 and like Green Day, like Dookie, American Idiot, like those two albums mostly. But as far as the style that we play, we're still very metalcore sounding. But my big influence like would have to be Between the Buried and Me. I aspire to be able to write in any style I want and make a 14-minute song and have all of it be good. So we're not quite there yet. I don't think we're comparable because we're still very metalcore, but those are what got me started, and like that's the band I look up to the most now.
I'm not going next. You go next. I got to think.
Me?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, my gosh. Sorry. This is hard.
All right. Bring it to Maxi.
I'll let Chris do it.
All right, so this was kind of, I guess, easy to come up with. I didn't really actually start listening to music, like, at all, because I was just a gamer nerd, and Ross over here was the first one to introduce me to metal, so I think he kind of eased me into it from Rock Band, but then I heard Day to Remember on Rock Band, and I got really into Day to Remember, and they're the, you know, clean vocals, kind of hard, and
that kind of... Fuck off with that clean vocal shit.
All right.
It's the same guy doing both. He's singing and he's screaming. It's not cleans and dirties.
I know. And so they really got me into the metal-ish scene, even though they're kind of punky. But really right now, the one band I really enjoy is August Burns Red, just because like they made metal sound pretty, I guess. I don't know how to describe it, but they just made
you said
metal.
August Burns Red?
Yeah.
Morgan, would you say they make metal sound pretty?
They're angry Morgan. Music for happy people.
Exactly.
Morgan also has
thank
a,
you.
They all look like the boys
next
door.
That's their slogan. That's what they say. They're slogan. angry music for happy people.
They all look like
Christian
models.
Core band,
they have positive energy.
But they do.
And
they give
lyrics.
110% every
yeah,
single.
Every
I mean,
time.
When we saw him at the rave.
I didn't.
He was. Yes, you were there. He was apologizing because he was sick when he was doing vocals. And he's like, I'm sorry, I didn't give it all I had tonight, blah, 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 I'm sick, I've been fighting like food poisoning or the flu or something. And I'm like looking at him going, are you fucking joking?
Right, exactly.
You could have fooled me. Yeah. Oh, I love him. I can't wait to see him next week.
Oh, me too, same.
I'll see you there. Parkway Drive is going to kill it.
Thanks for the invite, Morgan.
You fucking didn't
want to. But what about Polaris, though?
I'm going to probably miss them. I'm going to be late.
Damn.
I want to watch
Prada?
The whole show. I've seen them quite
Every We've time we so see Prada,
yeah.
somehow I always get punched in the face.
That's not true.
Oh, yeah.
Like, every time.
That's somehow? Not true.
They would love that. They would love to hear that. Mike Ranico would be proud to hear
He would be hyped. Absolutely. Okay, so I think I could go with my... I could go with my two biggest influences, like, vocally. Should I just do that?
Whatever
just keep
you
it simple?
Do.
Whatever feels right.
Well, okay, so my ride or die band, as I've said earlier in the podcast, is Bring Me the Horizon.
Skies.
Yeah. I mean, I found that band, like, randomly searching in Barnes & Noble's at an AP magazine. I saw Bring Me the Horizon. They had, like, a whole story. And I literally, my thought was, like, holy fuck, this guy has a lot of tattoos.
Oh, yeah.
And I was just like, that is fucking nuts, dude. So I'm like, I'm going to look him up, and then Pray for Plagues came on, and I'm like, yes! You know what I mean? I was so fucking hyped that I started learning all those songs. I
fucking love that song. Yeah. Hey, it sucks that he can't scream anymore.
Yeah, I mean, I think he can still scream. He just chooses not to.
Boom, there it is.
Every time I see them live, he like pulls a few little black metal highs here and there, just tastefully. And I'm like, I fucking love you,
man. He's still got it.
He's still got it. He just does it like for fun here and there. And it's just no one else cares. But I'm like, I've seen you since Count Your Blessings live in Chicago every time. So... this is great for me.
Have you ever seen the documentary No Room for Rockstars?
I haven't.
You should watch it. It's about like the Warped Tour and how everything runs and stuff. But it's kind of funny because on that tour, it was right as Bring Me the Horizon was starting to get really big. Mm-hmm. And right when The Black Crown came out, it was Suicide Silence. No, it was right when The Cleansing came out. You put Mitch and Ollie side by side.
They look the same.
It's creepy.
Yeah.
Because they are both so fucking scrawny on that tour. And the only thing that you can distinguish is if you knew what neck tattoos each one of them had.
Ollie has the big rose.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
So Bring Me the Horizon is my like number one band forever. I don't even, like, I've said this
the
before.
The jerk-off session started. I read your Facebook. Before. I knew this was going to happen.
I've said this before.
Open your mouth, Camille.
All my friends know this. God. Like, if they put out an album of straight farts or something, I would probably defend it till my dying day.
So what do you think of the song that they just made the music video for?
It's good.
Mantra is fucking awesome.
It's so good.
And the music video is fucking sick.
Their aesthetics are...
Their aesthetics are like, they're. I literally strive to like fucking get their aesthetics. Like,
I was really impressed with
it. It's so fucking cool, and their imagery and their marketing is just genius. Anyway, so my other band, since we're keeping it to two, is Architects, another ride or die for me. That band is my fucking like. I mean, I've seen them live even in Poland because that's where I go to visit every year for my family, and I've seen them out there. Like every time I see them. And especially since Tom passed, RIP, because I've been listening to them since Hollow Crown. So, like, I've been, you know, growing up with that band as well. And every time I see them after Tom's passing, like, I literally cry with Sam in the crowd with him because it's just like, fuck.
It's heartbreaking.
But it's like, but they're still putting on their all, like, during the show. And it's just like, there's so much fucking energy and love in the crowd. And it's like... the lyrics in Gone with the Wind when they play that last is like every time it gets to you.
It's an emotional experience.
Sam Carter is the...
the best fucking vocalist.
I would argue he's the one vocalist that screams as much as he sings and does it full out like all the time. You know, it's like him and Spencer from Periphery, I think, are the only dudes that can match and surpass what they do in the studio live.
Yeah.
It's insane.
I would agree. Yeah.
Dude, Sam Carter, holy fuck.
Unbelievable
vocalist. To me, he's like the epitome of like a metal vocalist. Me personally. He's fucking amazing. So those are my two, Architects and Bring Me the Horizon.
All right, Josh, you go.
I'm going. Okay, so first two, just quick blips. My parents were like, my mom was like Southern, raised in the South, and my dad was raised on like the East Coast. And my dad was like a Motown baby, and my mom was like, I guess, like Christian traditional type stuff. And my mom got into like Black Sabbath and Led Zeppelin and Pink Floyd. And my dad got in, you know, obviously into Motown. So where they met, I don't fucking understand remotely. But so Pink Floyd for me was like the first band like growing up that was just like, not only can music be like this like really enjoyable experience, like eating food like can satisfy you immensely. but can actually be about a lot. And you can have so much like creativity in your design, artistically, music video wise. I mean, watch The Wall and, you know, be floored, stuff like that. And I think the Pink Floyd of my current years has been The Mountain Goats. Very folky with punk vibe, singer-songwritery type stuff. That's like super heavy lyrically in terms of like its emotional content and whatnot. So I'd say the two of them tie for me in terms of like their impact on how I view music and how I view myself as a musician, operating as a musician. And then I'd say for metal, I don't know. I'll probably go Monuments. Just because I think that I'm a huge Chris Barreto fan. Chris Barreto was the vocalist, one of the vocalists before Spencer Sotelo and Periphery. But Chris Barreto had like, he was in Friend for a Foe, and he's currently in Monuments. And I just think that The Amanuensis is like such a phenomenal album in design, in its concept, lyrically, and musically. I mean, I think the guy is able to scream anything and sing anything. I mean, he's got like, he's like Michael Jackson singing and like Meshuggah screaming. I think he can do anything in the world. I think that Chris Barreto is the man. And then John Brown as like, John Brown and Ollie Steele is like, you know, brain children for it. Adam Swan and whoever the fuck their drummer ends up being. They always swap drummers. But Monuments, I'd say, is like the epitome for me in the metal world. I think that you'll find no better like vocal rhythms, like technical expertise, and like appropriate restraint and all that. It's great. It's great. Monuments. Hell yeah. Chris Barreto, I love you.
Interesting. Yeah, so this is, it's a weird question because I've been asked this on several occasions and I have never been able to give a solid answer because I am one of those weird people that like, I never, like music hit me late. Like, it's not that I didn't, like I would play an instrument. I've played drums since I was 9, but I never cared to listen to music. It was weird. Like, I just played it for fun, but I never like listened to music.
So it was more self-taught?
Oh, I was definitely I definitely taught myself how to play, but I was subjected to all sorts of different music to the point where like someone tells me, what were you influenced by? Like, what's your style influence, or what did you listen to where you were like, holy shit, this is groundbreaking? And I can honestly say there's really not many that I've actually listened to and I've been like, I want to be like that. So I can't really say I have a influence.
Yeah.
Now, as far as bands that I enjoy, one of the first metal bands I really liked was August Burns Red, just like Chris had said, because of Matt Grainer's style with his drums. So that was pretty cool. And I was just like, all right, this is interesting. I wasn't a metal fan at the time. So I was like, all right, they have a very interesting take on this. But I started drum set as a jazz player. And as much as I enjoy jazz, jazz isn't something that's very memorable to me, as well as to a lot of people. And it's awkward because we are currently in a
listening to jazz live.
I can honestly tell you that I love jazz. I'm not going to remember any of this shit when I leave. I'm not. I mean, is anyone here going to remember any of this?
It's a design thing, though.
I haven't remembered it for the last 3 years.
I mean, I would argue it's a design choice, though.
Sure, but my point is that's where I started, and it wasn't a memorable experience because I didn't remember really anything that I was playing even when I was performing it. Like I was so like analytical when I was playing. I wasn't really thinking of it like as a groove or how I feel the song or whatever. So I can't really say that with certainty as far as influences are concerned. I can say now that I'm older, like that's starting drums. As I'm older, there are drummers that I absolutely think are phenomenal now. I don't know if they influence my playing, but Blake Richardson from Between the Buried and Me is unbelievable. I mean, he's unreal. Thomas Lang is probably, in my opinion, the best drummer in the world right now. And nobody knows who the fuck he is.
Who's he playing with right now?
I don't think he's playing with anybody, to be honest with you. Yeah, he played with Stork. He's a main, like, he's just a professional like solo drummer from Australia. Unbelievable. He even tried out for Dream Theater. And
really?
He tried out for Dream Theater when Mike Portnoy left. And they basically told him, you're kind of too technical for. they didn't say that, but it was kind of inferred that he was a little too much, basically.
I had
but
not saying that he was too technical, but
they just said he was
different
too,
reference.
Yeah, he was just too. Yeah, he was just too much. But Thomas Lang is probably still the first drummer that I actually watched play, and my mouth was. I'm like, all right, well, I guess I'm quitting. I guess this is like I don't want to ever play ever again. So, yeah. And then as far as bands are concerned, Dylan and I listen to very similar bands. So, like, Devil Wears Prada and, A Day to Remember and all those, Parkway Drive, all those bands that were in the early 2000s. I just enjoyed all of them. But I wouldn't say that I ever, was married to one of those bands as one of my favorites. You know what I mean? So,
yeah. Being a metalhead in that time period, if you didn't love, everything that was coming out, you were weird.
True.
Like, Parkway Drive was great. Killswitch was great. All That Remains was great. Shadows Fall was still around. They were great. Like, every band was just great coming
Metal
out with great
was
shit.
Thriving at its best. Really,
yeah, man. it was great. And then, everybody moved the fuck on, which is fine and good, I think. Everybody's gotten better in some way, shape, or form.
Why are you pointing at me?
Take it away, Morgan.
I think he's just wanting me to give up my metalcore love. He's like, why doesn't she grow out of this shit?
I don't think it's a growing out of it. I think it's just the dudes in Killswitch and All That Remains, et cetera, they're all they're like men now. Certifiably men now. Men. Some of them have families. They're men. I get it. It's fine.
None of those guys have kids.
Phil Labonte grew out of it in the wrong direction.
This is very
facts
true.
Of life. Yeah. Facts of life.
Yeah. But let's play. We haven't heard too much of the Synovial music yet. Let's play a twofer. Okay. I know we're wanting to go in order. Oh, so the next two tracks after Chain Link are what?
Ether and Nurture.
Yes.
Ether and Nurture. So we're going to come back after listening to two tracks.
Cool.
And we're going to discuss what those are about.
Yeah,
here we
go. They're the heavier ones, so have a fun time.
Oh, yeah.
More Synovial. The clock strikes, the half moves inside.
so sick of your self-righteous bullshit. It's only you will know the pain that it's now. God will heal you from your pretentious crown. Let Raccoon talk to hell himself.
Thank you.
won't you carry us from Ava? Heroic rebel in the garden of metal. Take the flame as every woman and child are finally settled. And our force of prayer witness to the sickness. Our all sad existential fruit of business. And the relic of religious fiction. How will it be when it's all said and done?
Hey, you listen to Extinguish the Sun. This is the Metal Experience.
Fucking tear it up.
Is that your hand on my girlfriend? Is that your hand?
Chad Kroeger's.
I wish you'd do it again.
I forgot the rest
Chad
of the lyrics.
Kroeger's
sorry.
Okay.
I need Mike. I need my buddy Mike to like
We're,
duet that with
the Metal
me.
Experience. That was Nickelback joining us today in the studio, or at least our rendition of Nickelback tonight. Thank you, Camille.
You're welcome.
I'm Morgan Danielle with Luco Blaze, Chuckling Charlie over here. We are hanging out with Snowbeal. That was two awesome tracks that we just heard by the band. And what were those two tracks called?
Ether and Nurture. Nurture.
Ether James. And Nurture. What are those two songs about?
Okay, so Ether instrumentally was written as a joke, mostly by Ross and I, but Dylan's riffs were core to the like the
riffage.
It was honestly we were just like let's just fuck around for a track. It was like how many breakdowns can we throw in a track and how goofy can like we make this? Like how like you know hype machine can we kind of make this? And lyrically, I watched Amityville Horror and then fell asleep.
Nice.
And then woke up and wrote the song. And it was just like. What if this guy is dreaming that he's saving his kids and he's convinced that he's saving his kids, but in reality he's killing them.
Right.
There you go. That's Ether.
Nice.
Happy family.
It's
fun
a happy
time.
Song.
Yeah. It is a happy song.
Right. I felt very uplifted.
It's good.
Yeah. It's basically he's dreaming, but he thinks that, he's saving people and in reality,
He's choking them all to death.
What I really like about that song too is that so one of the bigger parts of it, like that everyone likes, is the breakdown at the end of the "I'm so sick of your self-righteous."
It's fun,
bullshit.
And all my good friends like always mock that part. Like they'll see me and be like, "I'm so sick of your self-righteous." They'll like do it in a really like screechy voice, and I'm like, "Shut the fuck up!"
Yeah, so
just come do that at a show.
It's funny
because I want you there.
The funny thing about that line was that I had written that line separately for, and I just had it in a notebook, and I just liked it, like the whole thing all the way until the "God will peel you from his pretentious crown and drag you down to hell himself." I liked that whole thing, and Josh had written like 70% of it, and. I showed him this line and I was just like, I wish we could have put this somewhere in this. Because Josh and I always wanted to make a song that was like stupid and dumb. But
we used to joke about it in high school all the time that we were going to say like just ridiculous profanities like
right,
the entire
right.
time.
And just make it, which actually really didn't end up that way. Because I think
thankfully
really two swears in that the whole song, or maybe one. Right. But I remember I sat there and Josh kind of like looked at it. And then he looked at his, you know, kind of what he had, and he goes, "We can absolutely put that in there." And I'm like, really? I don't think it fits. He's like, oh, it'll fit.
Oh, that could be done.
And then we put it. So basically that part, like, we kind of force fed it at the end of the song and made it a big fucking breakdown. And that breakdown, I remember I was like 19 and I was working at Walmart and I was in the dairy department and I hated being there. But all I thought about were breakdowns the entire time I was back there. And while I was filling milk, that rhythm came to mind. And I was like, that's going to be in the song.
We should have called the song Filling Milk.
Yeah. And so that's how that whole breakdown came to be. I have that whole breakdown on my phone, like my old phone. The entire breakdown of me just spitting it into my fucking phone.
Gung 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 gung.
Yeah. Done. Gah!
You'd be surprised. You'd be surprised how much of this band's material has been dictated beat, like via. Gum 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 gum.
Yeah,
it's dumb as shit.
And Dylan's sitting there like, is that kakum gum gum or is that shakum gum? This is like, no, it's shakum gum. Would you listen to me, Dylan? Open your ears, man.
It's like a whole new language you guys have.
And then our joke song became all of our friends' favorite song.
It's literally like it was the most played song off of Triage. Yeah. Everyone, they're always like, you're not playing Ether at this show? What the fuck? Like, I'm sorry, man.
Yeah, but anyway, that's what that one is. And then, anyway, so Nurture, which is the other one, Nurture was about, I had written that one about essentially a cult, like way back in, like, you know, talking Pitchfork days, you know, like witches and shit. But, like, it's a cult and basically a whole entire, I thought about it as, like, there are so many people that murder and kill and do stupid shit in the name of God and religion and all this stuff. And I think that religion, I think that religion can be used for good things. And I think that historically speaking, people have sometimes made it so much worse. Most of the time.
Yeah.
Almost 100% of the time.
So
so this song was kind of like a story about essentially a cult that they had leaders that were killing people in the name of God. And this one person, and I kind of thought about it like in my, you know, as I was the character, was how would I feel if my own family were murdered in the name of God, being in a cult, essentially. And people have done that historically because their faith has been greater than their love for their children. And to me, that's like asinine. Like, to me, that's crazy. But people do it, and people have a higher faith than their love for children or their family. So I thought about it.
I.e. like Westboro type shit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it basically became this thing of, okay, this guy's going to revolt. He's going to get a bunch of people that also had losses, and they're going to overthrow the leadership, essentially, of this cult. And they do that. But at the end, when they kill everybody, everybody looks to him as the leader of this revolution, essentially, and he basically sits back and realizes that he's no better than any of the people that did the murdering because he killed everybody. So
shit's deep, son. Yes. Shit's deep.
Right. And then what I like about it is that the chorus is about there's one of the first choruses. It says that 20, there's 40 in the back room, 20 down the street, telling them where, you know, people are, like dead bodies, essentially. And 10 more grasping at our uncalloused feet, meaning uncalluses. And we've never done this before. We've never done this killing. But it's the biggest word is our uncalloused feet, meaning there's a group of people. And I won't give away because everybody can have their own interpretation. But later it goes, you know, 60 in the back room, 40 down the street, 30 more clawing at my uncalloused feet. So now he is alone. So
uh-oh.
People don't. Yeah. So I'll let people decide what that means. But I think it was a cool little idea that I wanted to run with. So
fuck,
that's
yeah.
crazy. So is your language called Synovian?
What?
Excuse me? Excuse me?
I can honestly say that's a question I've never thought anybody would ask.
Of the stuff that you guys say that you communicate with, like, trying to come up with how you write your songs.
Oh. I mean, I think you just got to
It sounds like your own language.
Yeah, I don't know. Synovian.
I don't know. Like,
yeah.
I mean, I think enough of us do this just, like, with band songs anyway. Like, you just, like, listen. Well, yeah, you think about it, man. Like, I don't know. I think there are a lot of different kinds of listeners in this world, and I think a lot of people just like, I think there are a lot of casual listeners, and I think there are a lot of active listeners, and I think the active listeners pay greater attention to the entire package. And I think if you can assess what something is getting across instrumentally and weigh that against what it's trying to get across lyrically, then you can like find like the true essence of the song, hopefully, maybe, if that's how you decided to design that. I mean, it all depends like on a million things, but I think we can all agree that lyrics are a huge factor in songwriting. I mean, there are plenty of bands that don't, and they make great music even still. But I think that lyrically, I would be furious if we were talking about like dumb shit. If we were just writing songs for the sake of writing songs, I mean, we could do that. Anybody could do that. Like, you know, talk about something that matters, or like that you like get the inkling to write about, have passion for it. Dylan wants to say something.
Yeah, as far as what I think she meant, which is like the da-da-da-da-da-da stuff.
That's what I meant.
So yeah, yes, that is.
But that was a very down-to-earth, heartful answer. That is Synovian. And I appreciate it.
Yeah. But what's funny about that is if you go to the YouTube video for Nurture, there's one comment. Well, one comment in our reply to it. But the one comment is just like a bunch of nonsense that I can tell by sounding it out loud is supposed to be the first riff. It's just someone
dun 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 dun.
Yeah, someone types out like na 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 da 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 na 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 da 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 da.
Someone gets it.
Yeah, so someone obviously understands the language.
Speaks Synovian.
It's like secret Morse code or some bullshit like that. Sorry for not understanding.
No, it's good.
This is the second time this has happened, but we let this one go. We let Josh just carry it away.
But that's another thing about you guys is you guys are so intertwined that you guys know each other so well that's acceptable. And I think that also comes in with that language too, is you guys are all so well connected within each other's thought process with your music writing.
Primarily within each other. Like synovial fluid in joints.
Almost like.
I think that goes back to what Ross was saying. How
jeez.
Everybody just, or we just came as if we would mesh together rather than, you know, hey,
right, rather than
you.
Like, hey, this person's a very good musician. They're going to be what we want them to be in the future.
So what we're saying is we're all like half-assed musicians is what we're saying.
Essentially, yeah, right.
Do you think that it helps that you guys all came from the same area and the same school and you kind of met each other at a different point in your life, but you guys had that same kind of upbringing around the same environment that helped connect you guys better?
I'm going to say maybe.
Maybe.
I don't know.
I'm
going to
say hard maybe.
Yeah, but I mean, for real though, hard maybe, because I don't know that.
There are definitely, it could be argued yes, and it can be argued no.
Yeah, it's certainly not a conscious thing. I don't think that any of us think about like of course, like we all know that we grew up around the same place, but like, I don't know that's at the forefront of any of our minds when we talk, whenever we consider like how we relate to one another or how we speak to one another or interact with one another.
Right, on a personal level, I don't think so. Maybe as far as like how we try to, you know, like our creative process. Maybe.
Yeah, sure.
Because we all listen to the same music around the same time and we kind of grew up with what was popular and what wasn't, and we've all,
I
don't know,
we also
developed
branched
from there.
Like Dylan super proggy. Camille came from a super hardcore background, so
sure,
it kind of just blends.
Yeah, I think it's like, it's sure. If it is a yes, then it's like it's a loose yes, because I think all of us reached
a
different.
Hard maybe loose yes.
Yeah, hard maybe loose yes.
Like 60% yes, maybe.
Yeah, if anything, it made it like go quicker, because I'm pretty introverted, or I was at the time. I'm not as bad now, but when it was just me and Ross, you know, both of us were kind of like, you know, we kept most of what we were doing to ourselves. So being comfortable already with everyone, or at least knowing something about everyone coming in, made it a lot easier to, you know, kind of decide who we wanted to be in the band. Me having prior band experience with Josh, I already knew that he was the only other guitarist I really wanted to work with. So, and I mean, when it comes down to it, I think we made like the best choices that we had available as far as who to have in the band. Like, I think we're all pretty good at what we do. So
Yeah, we're competent, I would say, at least. At the very least.
Fingers crossed, yeah.
Hopefully.
That's a hard maybe again.
Once again, yes, hard maybe.
We don't get to be the
argue, yes.
We don't get to be the judges of that.
No, yeah, we are not the judges of that.
Luca, we've been talking this whole time, and I totally forgot you have a segment to do.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
That's a hard maybe on that one, too.
All right, here we go.
Could I speak to the drug dealer of the house, please?
Let's hear it from the soundboard.
Okay.
Now it's time for...
Hey, man, look what I found!
Only on the Metal Experience.
Oh, my goodness. All right, this week and every week, always brought to you by our friends at Imprint Recordings. Your music, your imprint. Visit imprintrecordings.com for all the information, for all your recording needs. And this week, Morgan also tells me that... Whew! Our Song Due winner for August 2018. And... Songdo is India's largest networking of musicians and listeners. They're a platform that helps provide opportunities for independent artists overseas. All right, we have all the way from Goa, India. I may be pronouncing it incorrectly. I probably am. The band Within Series with the song State of Emergency. Let's do it!
Well, I expect that type of language at Denny's, but not here.
Well, that's too freaking bad. You hear me?
Because we're throwing it back to Morgan and Luco on the Metal Experience.
All right, that was Within Ceres, C-E-R-E-S. I may be pronouncing that incorrectly, but the band Within Ceres from Goa, India, and that song was State of Emergency, brought to you by Songdo and our friends at Imprint Recordings,
Keep killing it, guys.
Keep doing it.
I just gave them a like on Facebook.
Yeah, so. That sounds super good. Cool. It sounds really good, honestly.
Tight.
Definitely something that I would listen to.
Same.
You guys, congrats to you guys for doing a good job.
Morgan.
Picking good bands.
Congrats.
Seriously.
Congrats.
Good stuff.
I chose them out of 5 contestants for this month.
Well, high five to those guys.
Yeah. High five to the other 5 bands, too.
Sure.
Yeah. The other ones were pretty cool.
Other 4, but you know, math.
The other 4. Yeah. 7. Math. The other 8.
Math is hard.
It's fine.
Well, we still 9. Got some more Synovial to play. Let's play another 2-fer.
Ooh.
Another 2-fer. Okay, these are going to be...
It's Temerity and Turn Your Back.
They're going to be much different from each other.
TTs.
Yeah.
All right.
That works.
Indeed.
We'll talk about them when we come back in. Here is Temerity and Turn Your Back.
Give me your
And now, back to the Metal Experience.
Did you say hookers and blow?
No, I said the Metal Experience.
That's not nearly as good.
Fuck you!
And we are back. I'm Morgan Daniel with Luco Blaze and our friends in Synovial. And hey. That was another two awesome tracks.
Just one.
All right. Yeah. So let's talk about those two tracks and what those are about.
Okay. So Temerity was like just like this amalgam of a bunch of riffs that we were writing, blah blah blah, instrumentally. Conceptually, this is the hard one. This is the hard one to try and reason. So we were writing about this person on a bridge, or some kind of like high place that they were contemplating jumping off of and killing themselves. And then, so Temerity is a conversation between two different people. It's the conversation like of the person wishing to commit the act, and the person, like the passerby, the wiser passerby, that wants to talk some sense into this dumb kid who's about to do this dumb thing. And the song is mostly our idea of kind of toying with. We're not advocating suicide by any means, but we're toying with the perspectives of the people, of the person that sees the person who desires this and thinks that they're a fucking idiot because of, like, why would you not want to live anymore? You're dumb. Like, that's, you should, like, live. Obviously, live, right? And then the person who's in the thick of whatever it is that they're feeling and whatever the causes are of whatever they're feeling, who believes so passionately that it is the best case scenario for them and for everyone in their life. So the entire situation is just this conversation between two people about what they want to do. And in the end, the person jumps, but that does not disprove the efficacy of talking to people about what they think might be right, even though it is so like painfully obviously wrong to do. So, it was us kind of taking a stab at that. And for the record, we did write the song, and
it was quick.
We wrote it in
four hours. When we were first recording, we didn't have any like lyrics officially like written for it yet, and we liked the song, and we were just like, okay, we have to finish this. We're already going to be recording this. We need to finish this. So Ross and I got together and kind of played through it and like solidified the structure then and there, and then spent a few hours just kind of writing down a bunch of lyrics and just like, okay, what if it's this? What if it's this? Where if it go? What if it goes here? Et cetera, et cetera. It was like a blitz writing.
It was crazy.
It was nuts.
This song is definitely the fastest song we've written. And it was funny because I remember Dylan was trying to get back from work as soon as he could. And Josh and I were just like trying to kill time. And most of the song was written, and we stole. Now, the main riff of Temerity is all Dylan.
Totally.
He did it a week beforehand. He showed me the riff, and I just told Josh, this riff is awesome and we're going to use it. And we're just going to tell Dylan that we used his riff. So Dylan shows up to my basement and we're like, we wrote a song. And he's like, okay. And we're like, we put your riff in there. And Dylan's like, okay. like had no say, but it ended up being the most iconic part of that song, yeah. His riff. We just placed it in there. And then, of course, he put in some of his cool little doodly-doos to make it much cooler.
Yeah.
Much cooler, especially the middle section. But yes, it has a very dark undertone to it, but it's a very theatrical song. And
yeah.
I think it's... I'm proud of it. I'm proud of how fast we could do it.
Considering the time. The second one, Turn Your Back, is like the forgotten one, I think, of the EP.
It is my personal favorite the EP, actually.
It's a cool one. It was just like I think I really wanted to write it. And there were a couple riffs that I think Dylan and I had come up with that it was just like, I really want to do this really bad. And we had the time to do a sixth song, because at the time it was just the five, and it was like, okay, we're going to do the sixth song. And the song lyrically is a lot of like my perspective on my relationship with religion and like my issues, my complicated relationship with it, my issues with it and my praises of it kind of like rolled up into one. And just like the idea that like you, like the primary idea is like really in like the first verse, just essentially like this, you know, you profess to have this intimate knowledge of the way that the universe works or that humanity works and was built for, et cetera, and you instead decide to like turn your back on like the open door that you have left to explore those themes and then focus on these trivial, for lack of a better word, like stupid things that have, I can't believe, have any bearing on your soul in the afterlife. So, yeah, you know, be a good person and all that jazz and explore and whatnot, ideologically and philosophically, what have you. But, yeah, the song's basically it's my at the time criticism of religion. And I imagine if we're still a band in 5 more years, there'll be another song like this that Absolutely. Pops up just to kind of like reassess the you know, the relationship.
And speaking of jazz, this is a song that actually delves in jazz for the first almost half of the song.
Yeah.
It's very, very not metal.
First half of the song was entirely designed to be like the spacey, like this honestly spacey exploration.
Underwater feel almost.
Yeah, I think I kept on saying that to Jake when we were recording it. I was like, can we make this guitar sound like
effects.
it's submerged in water, like submerged.
That sounds like Death Clock when they recorded their album underwater.
Yeah, but this is way less heavy.
Record liquid track.
This is way less heavy than that.
But
yeah.
It ended up being a very, very complicated rhythmic song.
Yeah, we've never played it live.
We never played it together.
Right now, we do not know how to play it. It was specifically written for the studio. We do not know how to play this as a band.
I would like to figure that out at some point.
At some point, it would be. I think it would be
an awesome.
It'd be neat
to figure out.
It would be
neato,
but it'd be very hard to play.
It would be neato.
What about an acoustic version? Is that a possible thing?
Sure, it would have to be shorter. I think.
Yeah, it would have
to be honest.
Shorter. Yeah,
I don't.
But it's yeah.
Yeah,
it's definitely one of the more like if you're into very complex rhythms and stuff like that, you can listen to that song 50 times and find something different. So it's a song that I feel it's probably one of the most underappreciated, if not the most underappreciated song on that album.
In my opinion, too.
And it's definitely one of my favorites. And
it's intimate.
Yeah, it's intimate. And I'm not dumb. I knew that it wasn't going to be a hit song on the record, but I hope that people appreciate that one eventually.
Eventually.
It was a great ride. It was an awesome.
It's a deep cut.
You guys have a show coming up.
Mm-hmm.
What are some of those details?
September 22nd, Side Street Art Studio. Is that the right name? I don't know. Either way, it's for Insa Palooza, which is run by CJ Inc. on Facebook. So it is a kind of like a little fest that he throws at the Side Street Studio Arts place in Elgin, Illinois.
Real cool.
It's basically like at an art gallery. We played it last year and it was, I'll say, interesting. It was
basically.
very hot. The atmosphere was very cool.
Yeah.
Didn't bounce well in the I can't call it a venue necessarily, the room.
We're literally just playing in a room, but I think the charm of the room...
It was fun.
The charm of the room is the fact that we're playing in a room filled with personal art. Like these are local artists that have put their pieces on display. So you're playing with them kind of like looking at you.
It's very cool.
It is strangely satisfying. But last year it was
so
fucking hot.
It was fucking hot.
Yeah,
We're playing it this year. We're playing on the Saturday of Insapalooza, September 22nd. We are playing with Tanzin, the Levitated, Pickwick Commons, and Luca.
One that is a sick lineup.
Should be a heavy fucking
totally,
show.
It's totally free, but like it's saying, free it's for local artists. That's why you could they just like donations.
Yeah, they like $5 yeah. Suggested donation. You know, because it's an art place. Like yeah. You should if you can.
And but for the record, it's in a different room of the.
It is. It is in a different room this time, which I think, from what CJ has told me, it's in a better room in terms of like the more. Room. DIY scene sure. Of shows.
You'll be able to breathe.
It'll be a very intimate right. Show, but it'll right. Be a lot of fun.
Yeah, and everybody should go Friday night too because our buddies in
Lower Automation.
They're oh.
Those guys are so good.
They're so good. We played there. With
we
them.
Played with them at that place last
yeah,
year,
and it was they were so good.
They were
if
a
you
lot
want,
of fun.
If you want a show, if you want to see some people play like the shit out of their instruments, go see Lower Automation. Find Lower Automation, yes. Like them, like their shit. They're really good dudes.
Their newest EP yeah. Fucking kicks ass.
They're talented as hell. They're noisy and it's great. It's great. Yeah.
But yeah, September 22nd, Elgin, come out. It's free if you want it to be, unless you want to donate to the art studio. Yeah, come check out your boys in Snowville.
Yeah. And what about merch? What do you guys have available for
so fans? We actually just opened up an online store. We've got two shirts up there, and we've got like, yes, we've got guitar pick and sticker like combo packs, if you want to call it that.
Our friend Sarah made the goofy guitar picks.
The goofy guitar picks.
Sarah Cremant. I'm sorry, Sarah.
Cremant, maybe.
Cremant.
Who knows? Cremant. She's great. She's
Chris agrees with both those.
She's
yes.
He's just
yes.
Shaking his head. Yes,
she's
that's right. No,
she's
yes,
a really
that's
good,
right.
She's a really good artist. I have a lot of her pieces at my apartment. She's really talented, but she helped us out with that.
Yes.
We have certain sizes left. In
yeah, we only have smalls in one of the shirts, and then we only have medium through double X in the newest shirt, the navy one that kind of represents 525. Once again, there's daisies there. There's two petals falling. Use your imagination.
If you want long
and
sleeve
hands
shirts,
picking
spam
at them.
Our inbox.
This is a stumper.
But yeah, so that's synovial.bigcartel.com. Or the link is on our Facebook. And we've posted it on Instagram, whatever, Twitter. But yeah, be cool if you guys picked something up from us, helps us out, especially with recording stuff mm-hmm. in the future, and or come to a show and grab a shirt. Even yeah. Better, you don't have to pay for shipping.
Yeah, exactly. Yes.
That's a plus.
Yeah.
That's a plus. Yeah.
Well, some announcements going on before we wrap it up for the night. Our friends in Extraction Point are looking for a bass player. They are auditioning bass players who are 21 and up. They have pro gear, reliable transportation, and they have demo songs if you're interested. They jam in Lombard Friday, Saturday, and Sundays. You must be able to make at least one of those practices. So not too hard.
What were they looking for?
A bass player.
A slap at a bass.
Slap in the bass.
What's bass?
Our friends in Matiana are playing with Abigail Williams, Ghost Bath, Wolf King, and a couple more bands at Reggie's tomorrow night. So make sure you go check that out in the city.
Ghost Bath?
Our friends in Axios are playing with Sons of Famine and Metal Fire and Venom Inc. happening at Reggie's Friday, August 31st. If you keep laughing, you're going to encourage them to keep talking.
Sorry.
That's a terrible decision.
What did I miss?
September 22nd in Lyle, there's this awesome thing called Punk the Burbs Fest. It's the second one, I guess, and a few bands playing this just so you can get ready for it. It's all ages. It's going to happen at the Base Camp Pub. The Queers, the
nice.
Bull Veevils, the Runaround, Bumsy and the Moochers, Something to Do, Avenue, Stellar West, Bury Me in Lights, and more. Oh, the Guardrail is
playing. That better be a punk band. That better be a shit ton
it's
of punk.
It's called
Punk bands.
And the Burbs.
Okay, the Queers good. Have been around for a long time.
Yeah, and it's a bunch of aliens invading
the
this where's
that
neighborhood.
Oh,
it's I called Base Camp Pub in Lyle, September 22nd, all ages. Starts nice. At 12 p.m.
Lyle's neat.
Same day as Heart the show. Of Jordan, Lyle. We opened up with one of their songs today. And their new single, I, is going to be on platforms worldwide September 7th. So you can pre-order it in the bio link in their Instagram and on Facebook. And Luco's so mad he threw his pen. Great. August 29th, also tomorrow, our friends in Texas Toast Chainsaw Massacre, Night of the Round, Bloodletter, and Vicious Attack are sharing the stage at the Forge with Power Glove. might be able to still get tickets from any of them if you are still interested in going.
Power Girl is rad, man. Check them out.
Tanzan just announced that they are going to be releasing a new single that's super exciting called Left Swipe, dropping September 17th.
Nice.
So we will, that following Tuesday, play that song on our show.
Shout out to Alex Zarek for shooting that music video. Hey.
Woo!
Hey, girl.
Also happening September 3rd, Labor Day at Meltdown Creative Works in Bloomington. The Levitated are playing with Portals and Kanash.
Shout out to my boy James McHenry for putting on that show in Portals, yo.
Woo!
I went to college with him, too.
There you
Portals
go.
Is pretty sick.
Hey, girl.
What up? Our friends in Contra are going to be going on tour toward the end of September for the Inertia Tour, their brand new EP that's coming out. So catch them first in Milwaukee, coming to Chicago at the Wires September 23rd. And they'll be going to quite a few places, ending in Columbus, Ohio. On October 14th. So
we're not
check them out. Our Fool's Brew are going on the Weekend Warriors Tour.
We love them.
Starting August 30th at the end of the week, they're going to be in Milwaukee playing Sabotic. They're going to be playing September 1st at Rockford at Whiskey's, September 2nd at the House Cafe in DeKalb. September 6th and 8th, they're playing The Revival out in Maple Park. Then they're going to be in Bloomington September 12th at Knights to Shop, and going to be in Chicago at Livewire Lounge September 15th.
Knights to Shop?
Night Shop.
Okay.
All right. You Can't Kill the Boogeyman Tour happening with our friends in Alter Perceptions, and they're going to be playing with Raw Dog.
Raw Dog, bro.
God of Nothing.
Raw Dog
and a couple other bands, but they're starting out in Arizona. September 28th is when it starts. Going to end in California November 3rd. They'll be around our area. It looks like not happening.
Wait, what?
They're looks not like going to be around happening. Here.
It they're, looks like they're going to be in our area.
The closest,
never mind.
The closest they're playing is Detroit.
Detroit.
Wazoo, Wisconsin, or Indianapolis. Yeah. But sadly, Alter Perceptions is not making its way to Chicago. So make sure
to.
You just watch their page. But if you can catch them on any of these dates, watch the You Can't Kill the Boogeyman Tour. Sick Michael Myers artwork for your face, your maker.
Michael, who?
Michael Myers.
Michael Myers? Oh, okay. Michael Myers? Is that like...
All right.
Is that a musician?
I don't know. Anyway, if you want to be...
Is that like a professional tap dancer?
Up. If you want to be...
Michael Myers?
God damn it. I'm going to mute your microphone. Arabella are shooting their music video September 11th. That's next 2 weeks on a Tuesday. It's $5, hey. All ages, 6 p.m. You can go to the Waiting Room in Naperville. They're going to be playing with Luca, Blind Sacrifice, and A Sense of Purpose. And they're going to be filming their own music video there. So check it out. You can listen to their song Low Life in the
Arabella
link in,
kicks ass.
In their Facebook page event.
Hey.
Check it out. That's what they're going to be shooting the music video for. And don't forget, tickets now for Forever Death Fest are now online. It's going to be at the Beat Kitchen December 7th and 8th. And it's $35 for two-day passes, 17 and up. So a few bands are playing is Bloodletter, Snow Burial, Resin, What, November's Doom, Without Waves, Zaius, Huntsman, Varaha, Meth, a few more bands. Prosthetic Records has the second day. Bunch of other awesome Chicago locals playing that Friday. But this is all Chicago bands. So definitely check that out. Tickets are going fast right now. We are helping sponsor that. It's going to be amazing. Yeah. And next week on our show, we have our friends in Act of Destruction
going to
be rejoining us.
Oh, no.
Which means that Steve McCarthy should be stepping by. And
Megamo.
And we're just going to have a good time with our thrashing friends in Act of Destruction. I heard they have some new music to share. And we're just going to be hanging out, playing some awesome jams and catching up with them.
We're going to be in the dungeon?
I don't think so.
Okay.
This should be,
upstairs. It
until next month.
I kind of prefer the dungeon.
Well,
I've had a good time in the dungeon.
Yeah, it's been good.
Yeah, it's not bad. You could hear the jazz, hang out, don't get bothered too much.
Unlike many dungeons for many people.
Yeah,
our experience has been pretty good.
Out of all the dungeons I've been to, this one's been
Wow.
This one's been all right.
The most accommodating.
Yeah,
did you guys know that Dylan likes to go to dungeons?
Top 10. Top 10 would go to.
Top 10.
10 out of 10 would definitely dungeon here again.
Absolutely.
Well, we have one more track to play from Synovial, and I have to say this EP is fucking awesome, and I am stoked when I can finally see you guys play a show where Luco will actually bring me to.
Don't count on it.
But seriously, this is awesome, and I'm glad you guys came out of the closet and decided to to start playing, because seriously, this stuff is really fucking good.
I thought we were playing hide and seek. I'm sorry.
So the last track of the night to play is
Alter.
And any backstory on this?
Josh?
Yes.
Instrumentally, I'd say it's mostly Dylan's like kind of brainchild.
Yeah.
Dylan's all proggy and shit. Go mm-hmm. ahead.
Yeah, this is my favorite song, because this is like we had like a first EP that we recorded that isn't anywhere anymore, just because I didn't feel comfortable with the prospect of people hearing it. So out of all of those songs, which were mostly just the songs that me and Ross wrote together, Temerity and Ether were also on that, which we re-recorded, because those are two songs that we felt comfortable. They were written as a full band, so we felt comfortable giving them like another try, basically, and adding some spice to it. But this was the first song that I wrote most of that I was actually like super happy with out of all the songs we wrote up to this point. So yeah, Alter is my favorite.
Yeah, so it's the most progressive, you know. It's not in 4/4 for a very large portion of the song.
Yeah.
And Ross kind of gets to go ape shit for a decent amount of the song. Conceptually, this
maybe.
Yeah. conceptually for me, because I took most of the charge writing this one lyrically. It's kind of about the idea that what if the human sacrifice tendencies that like the Aztecs and the Mayans had was actually like, you know, modern day science. You know, what if the things that these cultures and civilizations used this practice for was actually the thing that we, you know, globally, currently, right now, we're going to benefit the most from. You know, learning so much about the human body before textbooks, before Christianization, before modernization, before technology, et cetera, et cetera. The idea that human sacrifice is better for the greater good because of what this civilization will be able to learn from this practice.
Amen.
Fucked up. It's fucked up, but you know it's an interesting idea, I think, to toy with, because like, you know, you read it in schools when you're like in middle school, and you think that this is the most barbaric, like, fucked up thing you've ever heard of in your life, but this is a thing that sustained civilizations for years, like ideologically and productively. Like these places and these people were able to thrive because of these practices, because they believed it was genuinely benefiting each and every single one of them and their futures and their past, their present. So yeah, Alter is kind of like an ode to that in all these ways.
Extremely eye-opening.
Sure.
And musically trying to become that theatrical sort of climactic, whatever. Try to be with it, like in parallel with.
Yeah.
What it.
It has a big ending.
Yeah.
Yeah. The ending. The ending is the sacrifice, however often it takes place, actually occurring, and it's like a town wide or a village wide. Like
it's a very emotional.
Yeah.
Side.
Imagine the top of the pyramid. You know, the event is taking place, and all of the townsmen and women are gathered at the bottom of it, you know, in worship. So,
yep.
To watch the slaughter.
Thank you guys so much for coming out today.
Thank you
for hanging out with us.
Thank you so much.
It means the fucking world.
Yeah, this is love. This has been lovely. Let's talk Seriously. About movies and whatnot.
And definitely check out 525 up on Facebook and YouTube. It is a phenomenal music video. We have download cards, thanks to the guys for Triage, that we'll pass out at shows, as well as some stickers for those that are interested in business cards for checking out the band. And don't forget the bands that we opened up with the show, Heart of Jordan, their new song, Throne Alone, the album out now for Heart of Jordan, and the brand new El Famous music video and single, You Don't Know a Damn Thing.
Hell yeah, El Famous.
Gosh dang it.
And within Saris from India. State of Emergency, the track.
Yeah.
We play.
Fuck yeah, India's
so
cool.
Next week, Act Destruction will be on with us. The last song, Picture Egypt. And
Alter.
Think,
thank you guys
think
for
of
having
cool
us.
Things.
Thank you
Here's
for
Alter.
Listening. Enjoy Alter.